Thank you. Welcome back to this Mayor and City Council work session for Tuesday, February 11th, 2014, about 1:15. Apologize for being a little late. Kind of ran over, everybody got a little long-winded. Prior to this open session, we had a closed session. Topics of discussions were legal and contractual matters. Persons present were Mayor Rick Meehan, David Recor, City Manager, Council President Lloyd Martin, Council Secretary Mary Knight, Council Members Doug Simak, Margaret Pillis, Brent Ashley, Dennis Dare, and Joe Matresi. Also, we were joined with City Solicitor Guy Ayers, Public Works Director Hal Atkins, Public Works Construction Manager Woody Vickers, Jim Parsons, our Public Works Chief Deputy Director, Bud Eyman, our Water Superintendent. From Chesapeake Utilities, we had Jeff Tybold, Vice President of Chesapeake Utilities. We had Steve Ashcraft, Director, Bill O'Brien, Director of Pricing and Regulatory Affairs, Matt Evergreen, Regulatory Manager. We had UCropper Attorney, Risk Manager Eric Langstrom, Planning and Community Development Director Matt Margada, OCDC Executive Director Glenn Irwin, OCDC President Bob Givers, OCDC Vice President Jay Nur, OCDC Legal Counsel Tom Coates, and Executive also Office Associate Diane Chavis. There was a motion made by Councilmember Simak and second by Councilmember Pillis to adjourn the meeting about 1:15. The motion was 5 in favor with Councilmember Knight and Councilmember Ashley out of the room. Okay. Next on the agenda is comments from the public. Any person who may wish to speak on any matter scheduled for discussion, the work session agenda may be heard during comments from the public for a period of 3 minutes or such time may be deemed appropriate by the council president. Anyone wishing to speak may be heard. They should state their name and address and subject on which they'd like to speak. Anyone in the audience like to speak? Come on up.
Council President, may I make a statement that I may have to leave early for the meeting? I have a family issue.
Okay.
So
right,
if I get
you.
Up and leave, they'll know
thank
why.
You. Okay.
Well, Tony Chris, 403 Bayshore Drive, Bay Vista, number 18. I guess if I sit down long enough, I'm invariably going to come up with something to say. This is on the budget. And since it just says that it doesn't specify what the revisions are, I just wanted to inform council of something that I've learned since the last time we discussed it that I think is very telling, particularly with the room tax. If you recall, there was concern about meeting projections, and room tax came in higher than estimated back a few months ago. I had them look at that in Snow Hill. I had a gal go back and look at it because we were hearing a lot of ancillary information that other smaller hotels were hurting, and then we had room tax higher. And it turned out that the larger hotels were up as much as 20 to 22%, and the total overall tax was only up 3%. So do the math. If 10 or 15 large ones are up 20%, then maybe the other 300 are down. So, and I think that's a point of concern. Because it lends credibility to what you heard a number of times up here, including from people that had small rental properties that were having difficult years. It makes it make sense. So, again, that's something that will be ongoing and you'll have to look at, I think. You certainly don't want it to become – the success to become narrower and narrower is not healthy. Thanks.
Thank you for your comments.
Good.
Okay. Anyone else in the public? All right, seeing none, moving on. Our next new business is the bid opening for Boardwalk Arch Recoding. Council Secretary Knight, David, Terry, welcome.
Good afternoon.
Is there a bid bond required for this?
There is a bid bond required. And also, if you'll read the total bid, and I also want to point out that this is a combination of two things. One, the $40,000 that the mayor and council appropriated out of FY13 fund balance to paint the arch, but also in here is a line item for recoding the dumpster screen posts and frames. These are the dumpster screens that are along the boardwalk. It was part of Public Works budget to get those recoded. They're having the screens themselves, which are removable. Those are being done on at a factory where they can be the finish can be baked on. So this is just the posts and the frames that are permanently mounted in the ground to have those coated. And we just put it in as part of this contract since it's the same basic material and methods.
The first bid is from Allstate's Construction Company in Ocean City, Maryland. There is a bid bond. The total is $22,000. The next one is from Macari Companies, Inc., out of Stanton, Delaware. There is a bid bond. The total is $74,300. The next one is from R&R Coatings, Inc., out of Salisbury, Maryland.
What's the name again, Mary?
R&R Coatings, Inc., out of Salisbury. I just want to make sure. There is no bid bond. The total is $38,700. The next one is from Titan out of Baltimore, Maryland. There is a bid bond attached. The total is $35,000. The next one is from Master Application, Inc., out of Parsonsburg, Maryland. There's a certified check attached. The total is $47,500. The next one is from ProCoat LLC out of Salisbury, Maryland. There is a bid bond attached. The total is $48,150. Mr. President, that's all of the
all right,
bids.
Thank you. All right. Got a couple lights on here. Councilmember Tressi.
Motion to approve to recognize Allstate's Construction for a total cost of $22,000 and remand the staff for review. And I also have to say that we really need to review these pretty good because everybody else is going to cluster above that. So,
yeah.
All right. Councilmember Pillis?
I'll second.
I got a motion and a second. All those in favor? Voters unanimous. Thank you. Thank you, Councilmember.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Terry. All right. Next on the agenda, it's a discussion of license fees and fee structures for car wash establishments presented by License Inspector Mike Sherman.
Good afternoon, Mayor and City Council. Come before you with two items. The first one, would like to change the way the car wash business is charged. Currently, we're charging them by service bay and also mechanical bay. I'd like to change it where we're just charging a set fee of $233. Currently, we have one car wash business in the town, and they're being charged by bay at $58 a bay. So currently, they're paying $406. And all of these bays are really on one property. So my thinking was, is we have one business here. Let's classify it as one set fee, like a retail establishment and so forth.
Okay. Councilmember Tressi.
Motion to approve the request.
Councilmember Knight?
Second.
All right, I got a motion by Councilmember Tressig and a second by Councilmember Knight. Discussion? Councilmember Ashley?
Is this motion just on the car wash?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Okay.
Okay. All right, I got a motion and a second. All those in favor? The vote is unanimous. Thank you. All right, Mike, you're up again.
Yes, the second one, periodically we review the whether to increase license fees or not. Our last increase was in 2009. And prior to that, our fees increases were in 2005 and in 2007. And basically, it boiled down to each year was a 1% increase for each year. So I'm going for you with whether you want to increase it any this year or not. 1% increase is basically going to be about $18,300 increase in revenue generated.
Yeah. Councilmember Ashley?
Well, I think in today's environment economy, the businesses have enough expense on them. So I wouldn't be in favor of this.
Okay. Any other lights? Councilmember Tressig?
I'd make a motion to deny the request.
All right, I got a motion. I got a motion by Councilmember Tressig. Councilmember Ashley.
I'll second.
I have a second by Councilmember Ashley. Discussion. Okay. All right. I got a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Okay. Opposed.
Yeah, opposed. I got six in favor and one opposition. One in opposition. Okay. Thank you, Mike.
Thank you.
Yeah. All right. Next on the agenda is a request for approval to solicit bids for jet skis and ATVs presented by procurement manager.
Catrice Parsons is ill.
Okay.
I'm here today, and Ward Kovacs is here if you have any questions. This is for three ATVs and one jet ski to be for bids to be issued.
They've already been budgeted, right?
Yes.
Okay. Councilmember Tressig.
Motion to approve.
All right. Councilmember Simak.
Second.
I have a motion by Councilmember Tressig and a second by Councilmember Simak to approve this request. All those in favor? Voters unanimous. Thank you. Thank you, Martha. All right. Next up is a request for approval of FY14 Budget Amendment Number 1 presented by Budget Manager. Mr. Mayor, when your light came on.
Before Jenny starts, I just wanted to make sure it was clear that all of this information with regard to the budget amendment was online and was included as part of the agenda packet that we publish online that everybody had access to. So all these details were online as part of this packet prior to this meeting, correct?
Yes, sir.
Sir.
Thank you.
Okay. All right, Jenny, it's all yours.
Okay. This is budget amendment number 1 for FY14. There are several purposes for doing this amendment at this time. We bring forward any of the prior year grant balances that were left over, purchase orders that were open at the end of the fiscal year to allow to authorize spending for those purchase orders. We're recognizing $1.6 million from fund balance that was approved by the council on October 1st to pay for several items as we go through the budget. This still maintains a fund balance in excess of the council's desired level of 15%. We're recognizing additional grants that we've received since July 1st, and it accounts for Sunfest labor from one division to another. I'm going to step you through the revenue changes. In the category of other taxes, it increases by $233,000. $113,000 of that was highway user funds above the estimated amount. Those funds were applied to the street paving as per the council request. The other increase in that line item was $120,000 for room tax. The original estimated amount for room tax for FY14 was $13 million. To date, we are about 5% above the estimate for room tax for through December. This increases the estimate to $13,120,000 and applies the additional funds to the advertising budget. The category of due from other agencies is our grant. Licenses and permits I missed. That's the balances for critical areas and stormwater mitigation balances from last year for projects that were approved in the prior fiscal year and brought forward into this year. Revenue from other agencies, prior grant balances that are brought forward, recognition of FY14 grants. There are two large grants that we have received since July 1st. One was the state tourism grant of $450,000. The other was actually discussed with you last year, but it wasn't activated until after July, and that's the self-contained breathing apparatus grant for the fire company. We received a grant of $383,000 to offset the purchase of those units. Under service charges, I'm reducing the amount of parking meter and inlet lot revenue, and this is to offset the meters that were removed after the beginning of the fiscal year.
fines and forfeitures. We're recognizing forfeited funds received from forfeited assets to offset the purchase of tasers, 7 tasers for the police department that were approved by the mayor and council, some computer software and training. Under other revenue, we've received an insurance reimbursement for a CID vehicle, and this will go toward the purchase of replacement of that vehicle. Okay, under appropriated fund balance, we have $2 million coming from fund balance. The council approved expenditures for maintenance items, vehicles, and capital projects, the amount of $1.6 million on October the 1st. In the prior year budget, there was $200,000 budgeted in the fire company budget for the local match for the self-contained breathing apparatus grant. That money was not spent in last fiscal year, went into fund balance, and I'm taking it out at this point to add it to their budget so that they can purchase the apparatus. The same for the TAB funding that was left over at the end of last fiscal year. There was almost $165,000 of the $300,000 allocation remaining. Bringing that forward and adding it to their budget for this year. And then prior year purchase orders in the amount of $154,000. Are there any questions about the revenue increases?
Any question? No. Good.
Okay. On the expense side, increasing funding for the SCBAs, the self-contained breathing apparatus, $583,000. Again, that's $383,000 from a grant, $200,000 that was the local match budgeted in last fiscal year. Advertising is increasing by $570,000. $450,000 is the state tourism grant. $120,000 is the additional room tax. We approved dredging. One of the projects from the $1.6 million was $500,000 in dredging, $383,000 in street paving. The additional street paving money is from the highway safety grant. So there's a total of $496,000 going into street paving. This brought the total that we are allocating for street paving in FY14 to $1.9 million. There were various maintenance items. One was the boardwalk arch painting that we just opened the grant for. Other items like the street lamp posts, painting of those, the replacement of the fencing at the tennis center, some of the lockers and other items in the gym area at Northside Park, replacement power washer for Public Works, items that were cut out of last year's budget and then added back from fund balance at the beginning of the fiscal year. Vehicles, there were $315,000 for the purchase of an ambulance and 2 pieces of equipment for the Public Works boardwalk line item. Again, the $165,000 for TAB, $155,000 for purchase orders, and prior year grant balances of $142,000. So these are all items that were last year that I'm bringing forward to add to the budget for this year. Then the items that have changed since the beginning of this fiscal year, we've received an additional $65,000 in grant money, mostly that's Homeland Security and hazmat training. The Tourism County grant, we budgeted $270,000. We received $300,000 from the county. So I'm recognizing that additional money and adding it to the tourism budget. The $17,000 from forfeited assets that we use to purchase tasers and software for the police department. Again, the insurance reimbursement of $16,000 for the CID vehicle. There was a prior period donation, a large donation for the mounted unit. We have to use it in increments. It's for very specific things that it will cover. So we're recognizing $10,000 for some of the purchases that they needed in this fiscal year. The OCDC, we budgeted $90,000 from the county. We received $100,000, so I'm recognizing this additional $10,000 to pass along to them. And we received a donation from Coke to purchase an additional display for Winterfest. That was the polar bear Coca-Cola display that was up there.
Very nice.
So did I go through that too fast?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, everybody
yep.
All right?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay. And that's it for the general fund. Does anybody have any questions on the general fund?
Good.
Well,
one question. Go ahead,
okay.
Councilmember Ashley.
Just curious, what is our, I know you say we're within 15%. On our fund balance. What is the fund balance? Do you have a
I'm sorry. I didn't anticipate you would ask me that question, and I don't have that off the top of my head. Something that Martha and I would have to go back and review for you.
Okay. When you get that, could you
absolutely
email
it's going to be part of the budget process
all right.
for us.
Thank you.
Okay, and water and wastewater, there were only two changes. In water, we're recognizing $16,000 from prior year reserves for prior year purchase orders. The same thing in wastewater. It's $104,000 in open purchase orders at the end of their fiscal year that we're bringing forward. Transportation. And they are very grant-oriented in their fund and their department, so we have $1.5 million in prior year grants that I needed to bring forward and add to their budget, and $13,000 in prior year purchase orders. On the other hand, we had anticipated that MTA would fund six replacement buses, and they only funded three, so I'm taking the funding out for the additional three. Our portion, our local match for the funding of those three buses was $145,700. Ordinarily, I would be transferring that money back to the general fund, but we elected to use that to reduce our estimates for bus passenger and boardwalk tram revenue. So I'm leaving that money in the transportation fund. Okay. Is everybody all right with transportation?
Yep.
Okay. An airport. Again, we're taking $23,000 from prior year reserves for their purchase orders and reducing their revenue estimate by $15,000. We found savings on the operational side to offset those revenue reductions. The revenue reductions primarily are for T-hanger rental, and Jamie gave me some of the reasons, partly with the paving that has been going on at the airport. There was a lot of equipment, and we had to pull one of the units out of circulation to store the equipment so that it was out of the weather. And there's also been more turnover than usual in the smaller hangars. He still has a lot of a backlog for the larger hangars, but for the smaller hangars, there's a little bit more of a lag between when one tenant leaves and another one comes in. In the golf course, we are recognizing $11,000 from prior year reserves for their purchase orders and transferring funds that they had budgeted in part-time salaries to hire someone as a cleaning service to move down to contracted services because they couldn't find someone that would. We had to hire a company to do it. So just moving the money around to cover it. Sorry. Okay, moving on to the convention center. In the convention center, the main increases that we're covering are unemployment expense, the repair of the electronic sign, and prior year purchase orders. In order to do that, there were savings on the expense side. One of the large ones that I wanted to explain to you is the energy curtailment rebate. Terry signed us up for an energy curtailment program, and it resulted in $15,000 in a rebate for our energy savings at the convention center. Also, we had anticipated a larger increase in their energy cost under construction than we have actually been experiencing, so we were able to reduce our estimate for energy costs at the convention center by $21,000, operating costs by $54,000, and Larry was able to reduce his overtime estimate by almost $19,000. So that offset all of the increases that we had and also enabled us to reduce revenue estimates for hall rental, service charges, and the lease rental, the lease, monthly lease. And when the HMRA moved out of the building, we lost their lease revenue. Are there any questions about the convention center fund?
Anyone? No.
Okay. The only change in IT is the $12,000 from prior year reserves to cover their purchase orders. In the service center, a similar picture, there's $10,000 from prior year reserves for their purchase orders. And we have transferred funding from full-time salaries to fund HTE training. Two of the three positions in the administrative division are new. We are very heavy users of HTE programs, principally for them purchasing an inventory, fleet management, and work orders. So we brought a trainer on site to train and retrain the employees that are there, and that was the funding to cover that. Under Vehicle Trust Fund, bringing forward $3.7 million in prior year bus grants and our local match, the transfer from the general fund of $315,000 for the ambulance and the boardwalk sweeper, and recognizing a grant of $58,000 for radio equipment, and bringing forward purchase orders of $36,000. General capital projects increase $500,000 for canal dredging and street paving, almost $500,000 from two different sources. One was from fund balance and one was from the highway user fees.
Okay. Councilmember Tressi.
Motion to move the budget amendment number one to Monday night for first reading.
Councilmember Knight.
Second.
All right. I got a motion by Councilmember Tressi and a second by Councilmember Knight to move the budget amendment number one to Monday night. All those in favor? Voted in six in favor was Councilmember Pillis absent. Jenny, thank you.
Thank you.
Yep, you're welcome. Okay. Councilmember Tressi.
I have just one quick thing. Riding down the highway, the plows have done a lot of damage to the drains on the northbound lane, fast lane of the highway. So if we could have State Highway check that out.
Yep.
To have them look at those. I know that they're probably not going to want to do it until later in the spring, but just to bring it, put it on somebody's table so that they're aware of it.
All right, David, can you make a note of that?
Yes, sir.
And the other one, I was going to make a motion to adjourn unless the mayor has something.
I do.
Yep.
I thought so. I'll make it when you're done.
Okay.
Mr. Mayor.
Thank you, Mr. President. I received correspondence in the latter part of December from Delegate Al Carr, who represents Maryland's 18th Legislative District. And what he was passing on to me, that he was planning to introduce enabling legislation to facilitate local government ownership and control of streetlights. The goal is to improve accountability, reduce costs, improve service, and accelerate energy efficiency upgrades. And he said that this approach has worked well in other states. Terry, if you wouldn't mind coming up. What I do whenever I get something like this is certainly do the background and the research. The first person I turned to was Terry McGeehan, who regulates this for us and is involved in this, and told him what it was that was being requested. We got a copy of the bill, and I asked him for his opinion, and I'm going to let you speak to that, Terry, at this time.
Sure. What this addresses, the ornamental acorn lights that we have on Baltimore Avenue, Philadelphia Avenue, those are owned by the city. And we have to meter them the way we do what's known as a small general service. All the other lights that you see on Coastal Highway, what we call the Cobra Head lights, those are all owned by Delmarva Power, and we pay a fixed monthly fee basically to rent those lights. It includes the cost of the light and the cost of the electricity. So they're not metered. So whether the light's running or not, we pay the same amount. What this bill would do would give us the right to purchase those lights. We would not be required to purchase them, but it would give us the right to purchase those lights and then take over the maintenance of them. It would also give us the right to put up, say, an LED light, which right now Delmarva Power does not offer. So I think giving us the opportunity to do it at our discretion, I think, could be of benefit in the long run. Again, it doesn't require us to do it, but it gives us the opportunity to negotiate that purchase if we desired.
So after getting Terry's support for this, what I did was he asked if we would prepare a letter, and what I've done is I've prepared that letter to Senator Joan Conway, who's the chair of the Education, Health, and Environmental Affairs Committee, to support House Bill 628, Senate Bill 688, which is the street lighting bill. And he asked if I prepare a letter of support. I've passed that along to you. And the proper procedure is whenever something like this is brought to my attention, as I said, the first thing I do is go to whoever I think can give us the best information. Then my responsibility is to bring it to the council. It's your decision whether or not to send a letter of support. If you choose to send a letter of support, the proper way to do that is through the mayor's office as the liaison to Annapolis. So if you all do support this, I do have a letter prepared and we'll send it. If you don't, I'll put the letter back in my drawer.
Okay. Councilmember Knight.
Motion to send the letter of support to Senator Conway.
All right. Councilmember Dare.
I have a question.
Okay. I have a second to them. All right. Councilmember Ashley.
I'll second.
I have a second by Councilmember Ashley. I have a couple questions too. Go ahead, Dennis.
The bill
says that we could obtain the ownership of the existing fixtures that
That's correct.
Are throughout town?
Yes.
And from then on, it'd be the town's responsibility to maintain them?
Correct.
So this bill would only authorize, so the fact that we would have to buy equipment and hire people to do that would be something we'd consider at budget time then?
That's correct. And again, it doesn't require us to do it.
Right.
It allows us.
What's it? How's it address what the energy costs are going to be?
What it states is that a new tariff would be negotiated for the energy costs. It does not explicitly state what it would be. That would be worked out through the Public Service Commission.
So,
and it requires the utility basically to negotiate with us on the price, and it would include the fact that those, in many cases, those lights had depreciated to virtually nothing. We've paid them off. We paid them off, if you will,
many
times.
But I noticed the new street lights on the Route 50 bridge that the state highways installed being LED, and they're wonderful. I guess it's just a detail. If DP&L doesn't offer an LED light now, how will we get a tariff if we install LED lights? Then we have to get a tariff for them. I guess there's a way.
There's a way, and we, you would work with the Public Service Commission to negotiate the tariff based on the wattage of the lamp, and that's how it's set up right now with Delmarva Power. You pay a different higher rate for a 250 than you do a 150. And in this case, if I called Delmarva Power and said I want to put up a 35-watt LED, they just say, well, we don't supply those right now. We're still experimenting with them. In this case, I think a rate could be developed through the Public Service Commission that would be based on the wattage of the lamp.
Yeah, I think that the key thing here, it's enabling legislation. It gives us some flexibility. It gives Terry the ability to monitor that and come back to us with a recommendation if, in fact, he feels that would be beneficial to the town.
Yeah, I haven't seen the whole bill or anything else, but, I mean, DP&L still owns the poles. Are they going to be, as we could take control of these lights for how long, or just forever? Are we going to be on the poles for free, or,
Yeah, that would all have to be negotiated. In some cases, they own the poles. In some cases, on the underground, where it's underground, we pay rent for the light fixture and the pole.
Right.
So all that would have to be negotiated.
That's what I worry about, because as we're going through, they're putting up new poles and taking some out and whatever else. So if we have a street light on it, we have to put the street light back. So
right.
All right. So all right, I'm in favor of this. I think it's a great idea, because I mean, it could really cut our costs if it's manageable. So all right, I got a motion by Councilmember Knight and a second by Councilmember Ashley to move forward with this and have the mayor send a letter. All those in favor? Vote is 6 in favor with Margaret Councilmember Pillis absent. Terry, thank you. Mayor has one more.
I did have something else, and this went out as a news release. Wait a minute. Joe's watching Days of Our Lives up there.
You'll pay for that.
I know, I'll pay for that. He went to turn it off. We did have a news release that was put out by the Ocean City Police Department, and I'm not sure everybody saw it, and it's one of those things that anybody can fall victim to. So thank you, Terry. This one, and I just wanted to read it into the record. It's Ocean City citizens warned of one-ring phone scam from Caribbean Islands. And it says, the Ocean City Police Department is warning citizens about a current cell phone scam where the potential victim receives a one-ring call from many area codes in the Caribbean Islands. According to the Better Business Bureau, scammers are using auto dialers to call thousands of cell phones. The phone will ring only once before disconnecting. If the citizen calls back the number displayed, the caller will then be charged $19.95 for an international call fee and an additional $9 per minute charge. Area codes being used by scammers are 473-809-876-284 and 268. The Better Business Bureau suggests that citizens keep a close eye on their cell phone statements and contact their carrier if any unauthorized charges are noticed. All citizens are encouraged to research the area code online to see where any unfamiliar phone numbers originate from before returning the call. Just a heads up, you know, we all get those rings on our phone. It's so easy to hit, you know, call back or, you know, return call, and this is a scam out there. I know it was put out as a press release, but just thought it would be good public information to make sure everybody's aware of.
Mr. Mayor, I can tell you firsthand, I got two of them, one when I was on vacation and one when I got back. And it's 268-762-0159?
Yep.
Okay.
And they're from Grenada, the Dominican Republic, Jamaica, yep. British Virgin Islands, and what yours is from is Antigua, Barbuda.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
That's the number. So be aware. Right. Thank you, Mr. President.
No, you're welcome. Councilmember Matresic.
Motion to adjourn.
All right. Councilmember Ashley.
Second.
I have a motion by Councilmember Matresic and a second by Councilmember Ashley to close and adjourn the meeting. All those in favor? Vote is six. Vote is six in favor with Councilmember Pillis absent. Meeting adjourned. Thank you. Thanks for all coming.
Oh. Did you schedule a
You want to do this? No, I'm already going to let it work out. He is bringing it to a board. So, oh, I took it to the board already, too. Vince is coming.